Oh, hey, it looks like it's working. Oh, my goodness. Sure seems like it's working. Good morning, Bob. Thanks for being here. Oh, hey, it looks like it's working. Oh, my goodness. Cool. So then I guess the next test is to see if the in-house audio is playing. Good morning, Bob. Thanks for being here. Oh, hey, it looks like it's working. Oh, my goodness. All right, I'm just going to wait around a little bit until we hit 10 o'clock, see if anybody else jumps in. This is going to be kind of an off-the-cuff sort of a presentation, just working through some songs, one, two songs, and I want to just be able to share with you folks kind of how I approach figuring out a song just by ear. Without knowing anything about it, I'm going to try and choose songs that I've never heard before or never know that I've heard before and go from there. And hopefully we can learn some stuff. I might back myself into some corners. That's okay. We're all gonna hopefully learn from the experience, because I think this is something that is really important. It's not talked about enough, and I don't know personally how to teach it, and I don't know of anybody else who really knows how to teach it, if that makes sense. So that is the game plan today. Hi, Joni. Hi, Richard. Thanks for tuning in. First thing when figuring out a song is making sure your ukulele is in tune to match the pitch. Though this is sometimes not the most important thing, because a lot of times, especially if you're listening to like tape conversions or old songs that came off of tape, at some point there is some variation in the tape speed, and sometimes a song will be like, I don't know, 25% flat in a key. It'll be in the key of C or whatever, but it'll actually be kind of flat and off by enough cents that it feels like it's not quite in tune. That should be nicer. Rock moose. Moose? Mouse. Moose, maybe. Good morning. Yeah, so if you're not on my newsletter list, I do have a workshop coming up. We're going to talk about movable chord shapes, kind of based off the ideas in my book, Ukulele Chord Shapes. And in the workshop, we're going to move some things around, play some songs using different chord shapes, and figuring out how they work as zones on the ukulele. That is going to be April 27th, I believe, the same time, 10 a.m. I like this time for myself, and I think it works for a lot of folks around the world. And in the modern ukulele world that we often interact with here in the English language, let's say. But if you want to find out more about that, I threw a bunch of links in the stream description. So check that out. That's also a great way to support the channel. If you like this or enjoy this, you can do any of those things and help me out with my journey and the time I've put into this kind of stuff. Okay, so it's 10 o'clock. Welcome, welcome. We are going to be streaming Figuring Out Songs live. I should have all the streaming stuff set up so that you can hear the music that I'm hearing, and as I play along with it, you can follow along on the journey, because what I want to do is figure out songs on the fly as we go and share with you some of what I'm hearing and how I approach getting a grasp on what the heck is happening when I listen to a new song that I haven't heard before. And since I've been seeing a lot of the Jimmy Buffett kind of memorial concert that happened, I think it was in LA or something, Jake was there, so I'm seeing stuff come through from Jake. I thought we could look at a Jimmy Buffett song, and if you folks have any other ideas for a song that maybe we should figure out, throw them up in the chat. But I thought we could start here. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to play some of the song and try and get a feel for what's going on. Probably the first thing I'm going to be listening to is the rhythm, because that's something that is kind of built in. You don't have to think about figuring that part out so much. Usually the figuring out by ear part is related to pitches and frequencies and the notes and the chords that are happening. The rhythm is just like, you either got it or you don't. So that's what I'm going to be listening for, just trying to get an idea of what is happening in the song. So maybe we'll listen for an intro and maybe a little bit into the verse, okay? This is the Great Filling Station Hold Up. Jimmy Buffett, may he rest in peace.
I pulled into the regular pump, I was feeling quite at ease.
Okay, this is going to be a good song. It sounds like it's going to be a simple song.
50 cents worth, please. Then I jumped my partner with his trusty pellet gun. I said, boy, this is a hold up. Keep a pumping and don't run. And now I wish...
Okay, so I'm hearing a number of different things happening in here. First off, it's mostly 1-4-5 movements. And I know that just from experience. That's something that I cannot embed in your brain from this lesson. But what you can get used to is hearing the relationships between the different chords. And so you have basically three different sounds, three different kind of relationships within the sound of a key or the sound of a song, a sound of a harmony structure. And so if you're in the key of C, I don't know what song this, or what key this song is in yet, though I might have some ideas. But if you're in the key of C, your 1-4-5 is gonna be C, and then you can just count up your fingers. C, D, E, F is your 4, and then G or G7 is your 5. And the more you play these, you get used to the sounds that they have. And if our ear is attuned to, this is the most consonant chord. This is the home chord, the C, the 1. This is where we're always gonna come back to. And from there, you have the 5, which is probably on the opposite side of the spectrum from the C. It's the most tension. You're tightening the rubber band up when you go to the G7. And you start to hear that, okay. So where, if I could resolve to the most relaxed home place, where would I go? Well, I'd go back to the C. And so you begin to hear these changes. And they're always the same between keys. When you have a 1-4-5 song, it's always going to be these sounds, regardless of the key. The key just means what kind of pitch you're starting from, where the platform is. But the distances between the steps that you might be moving up or down, those are always going to be the same. If I go to the key of G, those movements between the chords are the same. So the more you do this, the more you're going to get used to figuring out exactly what's happening without even needing to play the instrument. You're just going to get to the point where you just like, you hear the changes like, oh, that must be the 1. So that's the 4 and that's the 5 and it goes back to the 4 and now it's back to the 1 or whatever it ends up being. You start to hear those things. Anyways, let's try from the beginning. Let's see if we can figure out what the key is. Now, I just have a hunch, I have a hunch that it's in G just from the way the instruments sit. This is another thing that you just kind of get used to over time. But I have a hunch that it's in the key of G. I'm wrong, okay? But how you figure this out is you can do it one of two basic ways, basically. Is you can play some chords and see if you can find a chord that fits on the 1. Maybe we'll start with this. It sounds like it's in a major key, right? This is, it's kind of, it's got that lift to it. And a lot of times when you have this kind of bluesy country style, not super often that it's in a minor key. So you're listening for that kind of, that happy lift to the chords. The minor is going to be, you know, a downwards feel, kind of sad, dark. And so when it's in a major and we're going to go looking for the root chord of the key, we want to listen for where we are most home. Okay, so in that most home spot, we can just experiment with trying different chords and see if we can find it that way. This is maybe the harder way to do it, but it's also more straightforward, I think, for beginners. Okay, so we're listening for, there's the one. Okay, so we're staying there for a while. That's really nice for us. So now we can try different things. Dun, dun, like there's my root. Dun. So I can try different chords. Okay, C, not C. G, well, G sounds closer, but it's not G either. Nope, it's not G, but maybe if you've been playing a while, you can hear the relationship and hear how G relates to the key that we're gonna end up getting to. Okay, what if I go to F? Definitely not F. Okay, and we end up, if you were to cycle around, you'd end up at D. And remember, you're only using major chords here because it sounds major, and we have isolated the spot where we're on the most consonant home chord within the structure of the song. That intro comes around real nice. It starts somewhere weird. And then, boom, we're home. That's the one. And it stays there for a while. So we have a nice opportunity to listen to what's happening. And if you were to play through all 12 of your minor chords, if you had really bad luck and you had to play all 11 before you got to the 12th one, and that was the right note, because there's the 12 different keys in Western music, you'd end up on D. Okay? And when I played the G, I heard that that was the four chord in relation to the D. The four chord was not being played in the song, but because the one was there, I was able to hear that distance between the chords and the contrast against them and know that, okay, G is not the key, but G is definitely in the key, so that, you know, as we play through the different chord shapes, that gives us a clue to know where we are without actually having to play the right chord. And once again, this is just practice, but hopefully by seeing me do this, seeing me kind of hash it out, it'll give you the inspiration and kind of permission and confidence to try this yourself, because you really, really, really just have to do it. Okay, so we're in the key of D. We at least know that we have the one chord is gonna be a D. So maybe for the folks with a little bit more developed ears, we'll listen through the verse, and what I want you to listen for is where you think, well, let's do it this way. I'm gonna lift my finger when it's the one chord and maybe go like this. So fist when it's not the one chord, finger when it is the one chord. And if you don't want those hints, close your eyes and try and listen for yourself and see if you can figure out where it is. We'll do it twice so you can check yourself, okay? So here we go.
Pump, I was feeling quite at ease. I rolled out my window and told the man 50 cents worth, please. Then I jumped my partner with his trusty pellet gun. I said, boy, this is a hold up. Keep a pumping and don't run. And now I wish I...
Okay, let's do it one more time, and I'll call him out this time, and let you know what I'm hearing along with. Okay, so not the one, we're circling around. One, here's the one.
I pull into the regular pump,
and here's a change. And we're back.
I roll out my window and told the man.
Change. Change. Then we lift, not back to the one. One.
Said, boy, this is a hold up.
Keep we turn around and back to the one. Okay, and this is something that it always surprises me, how many people just like start playing and they don't try and figure out. It's like, well, we need to know what the chords are before we can think about the chord changes. It's like, no, you can think about what the chord movements are doing, where the chords are changing first, because if you don't have that information, you're actually kind of in deep trouble, because if you don't know where to change, you're going to end up changing in the wrong place. Your chord's not going to sound right. And then when there is a change, then you're going to be like looking in the wrong place, because you might be on, it just throws everything off. If you know there's a chord change and you can hear the chord change, it doesn't matter if you know what it is, you have better data than if you just play a bunch of chords and like guess where there's a chord change. Okay, so how do you know where a chord change is, okay? This is one of the hardest things. If you can hear this, you're in great shape. You're gonna be really able to move along easily. You hear the chord change in a number of different ways, but it's the overall lift of the instruments is how I like to think of it. Okay, in this case, we have a lot of instruments. There's a lot going on, so we're not listening to a specific one. We could maybe try and listen to the acoustic guitar that Jimmy's playing and see if we can just listen to that part, but it's probably gonna be kind of busy. There's a lot going in here. You have the pedal steel, you have the drums, you have the bass, you have the guitar. There's the harmonica too, I think, in there. So there's a lot, but all together they form this kind of bedding. And what you're listening for is when the bedding does this kind of dance. When it moves, the whole entire picture drops and moves. And I'm not talking about notes, because notes move by themselves, but you can still be on the same chord. Think of the notes as sitting on top, and they're hovering on top, but below them, the underlying kind of tone, the underlying dynamic and terrain of the harmony is what moves, okay? So, even though there's stuff happening on top, it's still the same chord.
I pulled into the regular pump, I was feeling quite at ease.
And listen to the bass. The bass is really simple in this song.
I told the man, if the cents were please, then I'd jump my partner with this trusty pellet gun. I said, boy, this is a hold up. Keep a pumping and don't run. And now I...
Okay, so... this is another thing, all these things. This is why I'm doing this, is I'm trying to figure out how to explain these things that are like, you just have to do it, you just have to figure it out, you just have to put the time in. That's all useful stuff, but if there are tips or whatever, I would like to be able to figure out what they are. So if you have any questions, please put them in the chat. I'm really just flying by the seat of my pants here, figuring out this song. But hopefully we have an idea where the chord changes are at this point within the song. And if we use the structure of 1-4-5, then we are gonna have a really good starting point for knowing where the chord moves are. Let's jump right to the verse, because we know that the verse starts on the one, because the intro resolves there. We don't know what the intro is doing yet, so let's just skip that, okay? Like, we can figure this out, but it's kind of fast changes, but this is really solid. We know this is the one. Okay, there's our first change. Dun, 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 dun. So when we're gonna have two options. We're either gonna go to the four, which it is, or we're gonna go to the five. And that's the really beautiful thing about simple songs like this. Don't try and figure out Bohemian Rhapsody or Killer Queen first. Those are crazy songs. The harmonies are bizarre and weird, and you're not gonna be able to succeed with those at first. Start with something simple. Jimmy Buffett's great. Right? Simple songs, great songwriting. That's more about the story than it is about complex music carrying the orchestration. So when you have the 1-4-5, if you're on the right chord, you only have two options. That's what I love about it, is if you play one and it's wrong, you know it's the other one. But you have to know where the changes are, because if you play a change in the wrong place, then your two becomes backwards, right? You're playing the wrong chord in the wrong place, then you have to go back to one of your chords, and next time you hear a change, it could be any of the three because you're on the wrong chord, if that makes sense. So you need to make sure that you're getting the changes in the right place, but once you do, and you know you're on the right chord, then you only have two options, okay? So in this case, we're going D to G, which is the four, okay? And what we're doing here is we are assigning a chord name to what's happening, but the more important thing from a figuring out a song by ear perspective is to know the relationship between them, so that you hear the relationship and not necessarily the absolute chord names. Because those are the sound between D and G, unless you have perfect pitch, it sounds like the relationships are the same as going from C to F, 1-4. Or if you're in the key of A, you're going A to D. 1-4. Those distances always sound the same. So you can extend your mileage by a lot if you really pay attention to the relationship between the chords as opposed to exactly what they are. Okay, so D to G. Let's see where it goes from there.
I pull into the regular pump,
G, and then we go back to the one because it toggles back to that home consonant place. That's the best one to hear. If you can't hear where the one is, keep trying to hear where the one is because everything's going to resolve back to there. It's like this. If you were to play... Brutal, right? It sets that expectation of, we want to go back to here. We want to go back to the do note, the one note. But if we don't, we're on that anticipation stage of the chord change. And when we go back to that most resolved place, then we're on the one. So that's the best one to hear because it's the easiest to hear. Home, home, home. It's where we want to be. Okay. And then, okay, so let's go from there. What we're listening for, we got D to G to D, 1-4-1, and then we're going to do something that's a little bit weird, but it's an exception. And it's easy to hear usually. It's a signature move. It's not some random thing. Okay, so D, G, back to D. Okay, where's our next change? Okay, so here we can go G and listen for G. G's not right. A. A's not right either. So it's got to be something else. In this case, usually what you would do is listen for, is it a minor or is it like a seventh chord? Listen for this. Minor or seventh? Because it's not our 1-4-5. In the context of 90% of songs, 1-4-5 are your major options. You have three of them. 1-4-5. That's it. And anything else is going to be borrowed because those are the chords that naturally fit within the key. If you need to go beyond that, you're breaking the rules and you're doing something weird. So usually your other chord options, if it's not 1-4 or 5, are going to be minor chords. But in this case, listen, is it a minor chord or does it sound major or like a seventh? Right here. It's not a minor chord. It doesn't have that sad, dark sound to it. It's like another lift, a different kind of lift. So in this case, we have to think that, okay, so it's going to be another major chord or a seventh chord. And there's a few different moves you might make that are outside of them. And you just have to get used to them. This is the most common one, which is nice. But the rest are things that you'll learn over time. This is probably the first one you want to learn. Outside of the 1-4-5, what you might end up doing is going to the major 2 or the 2-7. Okay? In this case, in the key of D, it's an E7. Okay? That is the movement that we're making. And the way you can kind of, the way that I know these and the way that I've learned this sound is that this is the beginning of a Hawaiian vamp. You play 2-7, 5-7, 1. Right, so that's E7, then A7, then 1 to D. So I grew up learning that E7 is not in the key of D, but you use it in the Hawaiian vamp, and it's the 2-7. And it's a common sound, especially in like this kind of country music stuff. It is really fairly straightforward and common. It's a good one to know. It's one to get your ear familiar with. But it has a lift to it that's kind of weird. It's got kind of a to it when it moves. It's like a happy sound, but it's Listen for it one more time. Back to the one. And then we go, usually the 7 chords, especially in a song like this, in this style of a song, the 7 chords are going to point to their 4. Is that right? Yeah. Okay, so what I mean by that, their 4, this is a little tricky. We're going to get off in the weeds here for a quick sec. This is a little bit theory, but if we're on E7, from the context of this chord, we're in the key of E, right? So from E, if you count up through the E scale, you have E, F sharp, G sharp, A. So that's the four. One, two, three, four. A is the four chord for the key of E, because that's where the seven leads. Okay? Let's see. If I go from D, a lot of you folks will know this, to D7. That D7 tells your ear that you're going to the four, going to the G. And if I go from the G to the G7, we're like changing keys here, but my ear wants to go to the four of the G, which is C. And here's another one you might know, C to C7. This is a common one. It's gonna go to F. And you can work all the way through all of the keys doing this. You go major chord to its seventh, to whatever the next four is. And you can hopscotch your way through all the keys in this manner. In this case, when you go to the 2-7, the 2-7 always resolve, or the 7 is usually going to resolve to its 4. Its 4 in this case is the A. In the key of E, your 4 is A. So you're going to an A7, which in this case of D is the 5. Okay? So 2-5-1. That's a very common movement in music. Like you hear it a lot in jazz, but it's in jazz it's a minor 2. In this case, it's a 2-7. So E7, and then A7, and then D. Let's try from the beginning. Okay, so we're on the 1.
I pulled into the regular pump, I was feeling quite at ease. I rolled out my window and told.
Here's our 2-7, and then the 5. Okay, now from the 5, we're back into the normal framework of the song. So we're either going to go from the 5, A, to either the 1 or the 4. Those are our likely options. Not always, but most of the time. Once you're on that chord from 1, 4, or 5, once you've come back to there, you're going to go usually to the 1 or the 4. So in this case, we can try. It's not the 1 because we lift again. We go back to the G in this case. All right. If you have any questions so far, throw them up in the chat. I'm kind of what I need to do here. This would be clever of me. Yeah, new window. Watch me go. Is I can have them side by side here. I can tech. Okay. So from the beginning, on the 1.
I pulled into the regular pump, I was feeling
4,
quite
1,
rolled out my window and told
2, 7, 5, 7, and then the 4.
Then I jumped my partner with this.
Back to the 1. Okay, and when we go back to the 1, a lot of the times, that one you don't need to handhold. I don't feel like I need to handhold so much for that, because you're going to just get that over time, and it's one of those that you just need to get over time. Just when you go back to the 1, it should sound like you're going back to the 1. You're resolving all the way. And the way that you can think of it is the 1. If I'm playing through my stuff, could I stop the song there? Probably. If you go here, you're going to want to resolve to the A. And that's almost even like more anticipation because you want to go back to the root. So if you feel like you could stop the song there, if it sounds like it's resolved, done, you can just walk away, leave it hanging, and it's going to not annoy anybody and be obnoxious, then you can consider it the 1. You're back home.
I said, boy, this is a hold up. Keep a pumping.
Okay. And right there we go to what's a turnaround. Turnaround is when you go to the 5. Because you're taking everything, you're like boomeranging back around. You want to increase the tension so you can slingshot back to the 1. Because if you just stay on the 1, let's see. 2-7, 5, and then we go to the 4, and then the D. And if we were to stay on da da da, it's just, it's like kind of static, right? You just stay on the chord. But a lot of times what you'll do is you'll slingshot to the 5-7, and it's your turnaround, and it's gonna take you, swing everything back around, point you in the right direction, so boo, you can go to the 1 chord again and it sounds fresh. With music, a lot of it is not so much that you need to change chords. You change chords to fit the melody, but a lot of times it's like to create interest, to create movement. And if you're always on the same chord the whole entire time, it gets a little static, and you have to have a lot of other tricks in your bag to stay on that chord and really make it work. Your melody's got to be really strong, your rhythm's got to be really strong. But if you move chords a little bit, it creates a little bit of interest. You're like, oh, here's something different. Oh, here's something different. Oh, here's something different. And the turnaround is a big part of that. You could just stay on the 1 for that part of the song, probably. The melody might change a little bit. It sounded like to fit over that chord, it might not fit perfectly if you just stay on the D. But harmonically and like big picture-wise, you could probably do that no problem. But it's that turnaround that gives it the interest. Okay, so hopefully this is interesting. Hopefully I'm not going too slow. It feels like half an hour in, we're only like just getting to the chorus. One, and then 2-7, 5-7, 4, and 1. And we're gonna stay here until we turn around. And we turn around, back to the 1. Okay, and now here, you can hear this is kind of a country thing. This is one of those places we're on the 1, so when we hear the chord change, we're going to either the 4 or the 5. And then in this case, you can hear it lifts up, we're going to the 4. Keep a pumping and don't run it now. I wish I 4. Whoop. And it continues to lift up. It goes up, and then up again to the 5. And then we go back, right? It's not, you're not lifting up to the 4 and then going back down and resolving again. You're going up and then up again, because our highest tension movement that we can make is the 5 there. And so that is a clever move. It's kind of a cool thing in the song. Then I'll jump a partner with this 1. And we're going to turn around. 1, 4. 5. Now we go back to the 1. All right, same thing again. Yep. Whoop. Ooh, what is that? That's weird. I think it goes back to the 2-7 again. But where it changes is kind of in a funny spot, so it's not the same to our ear. Before, we were going from the 1, the lift was straight to the 2-7 from the 1, so it had a specific sound. You gotta get familiar with all the different relationship changes, right? So it's like you imagine a family. There's Daddy Shark and Mommy Shark and Baby Shark and Brother Shark and Sister Shark, whatever the shark family is. And you have like, okay, so I'm Daddy Shark. I'm gonna talk to Mommy Shark. That's 1 chord change movement. Okay, so, but Daddy Shark now is gonna talk to Baby Shark. That's a different chord movement. Now Mommy Shark is gonna talk to Daddy Shark. That's another movement in reverse, right? And like all the different interactions you can have between the group, you can think of them as family relationships. And a lot of times they're called relationships, right? And that dynamic between them is always going to be the same regardless of key, but you've got to get familiar with where they move from and all the combinations of them going from one place to the next. I mean, you don't have to. You can figure this stuff out. But as you get better at it, you're going to recognize more of these relationships, and you're not going to have to figure it out. You're just going to hear it and know that, oh, that is Daddy Shark talking to Brother Shark, or that's Sister Shark talking to Brother Shark, right? That's the magic of just practicing this and working through it. So let's see if we can figure out where we're going here. Okay, so we're on the 1. Going to the chorus. Turn around. 5. 1, up to the 4, 5, 1, and then again, 4, 5, okay, and then we go kind of a weird, really twangy thing, but in this case, it's the 2-7 again, but we're going there from the 5, It's kind of weird the way that it drops into that twang. It's a little bit different. It's like you're kind of taking a couple steps backwards into this weird side corner zone of where you're going. But I would guess that after the 2-7 is the 5 again. Probably, I would think. Let's try. Let's see if I'm right. Yep. Okay. And so we went to the 5 after the 2-7. Went to the 5. That checks out. And because we're here, we are jumping back to, okay, so we're probably back in 1-4-5. What's next? And we have the lift again. So we're going back to the G. 5, G. Right? The great thing about figuring out a song like this is that it's not Bohemian Rhapsody. It's not a Wings song. It's not a Paul McCartney song where it's like the whole thing moves the whole time. You have one part and then another part and another part and another part and none of it ever recycles again. Like you listen to Band on the Run or whatever or Bohemian Rhapsody. These are like story songs where they, the whole way, it's something new every time. Something new, something new, something new. And you don't recycle a lot. But with simple songs like this, kind of a country sort of a thing, Jimmy Buffett style song, you're going to have the luxury of recycling a lot of what you're figuring out. So now we're almost all the way through the chorus, and a lot of the chorus has repeated. There was only the one part where I went to the 2 and then the 5, but then we go back to the 4, and we can assume that it's going to be the same chord progression again, the same pattern. Because, right, Jimmy is a storyteller. He's writing the song and just framing the lyrics so he can tell the story. He's not trying to do something crazy musical. If he can do it with the same stuff he's already done, he's probably going to do that. So we listen for the repeating patterns as much as possible. Now I wish I was one is the beginning of the chorus. 4, 5, here's the 2-7, 5, then the 4. And then I'm guessing it's the same thing again, maybe. Whoop, 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 whoop. Okay, so we're on the 1. 4. Oh, okay, so it's 1-4-1-5. Just single strums, which is kind of fast and a little bit frustrating if you're figuring this out, because it's moving around quick. You don't get a lot of mileage for what you're hearing and what you're figuring out. It's a lot, it's more, kind of more work. Okay. 4-1-5-1. And then we're back to probably going back to a verse. Four. Yep. Reusing all this. Now we go 2-7. 5-4-1. And here we turn around. We go 4 to the chorus. Two, seven, five, four. Okay, and once again, that end part, it kind of mimics a little bit like the end of the verse, a little bit, where he holds the D, and it kind of sounds like it's the same vibe, same, you know, rhythmic pattern space. Okay, so it's mostly 1-4-5, right? Not much to it, except for the 2-7. That's the weird trick in this song is getting used to the 2-7. Okay, let's see where we go from here. Another verse. Just solo on the verse. Turning around. D. 5-1. And then another verse. Yep.
the crystal about as drunk as we can be. In walks the deputy sheriff and he's holding our TV. Rubbed us, then he cuffed us and he took us off to jail. No pictures on a poster, no reward.
And then here's the chorus. Okay, so the end there, he repeats the kind of fast part. It's called a tag. Okay, that the tag thing is very common, especially in Hawaiian music, especially this kind of music. You have a line that like reiterates the story of the song, the Great Filling Station Hold Up, which is the name of the song. It repeats to kind of drive the point of the song home, but also to, it's like a signal to the band, but also to the listener. Like, okay, this is it. We're done. We're reiterating ha'ina ia mai ana kapuana. That's the end of our song. And then we're going out. And then what you're going to do is you play more, is you're going to collect little pieces, little books for your library, tools for your tool bag of different ways to start and end a song. And in this case, it's like a very country blues ending. And this is like one of a very common ending that you'll get used to hearing. Right? So da 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 da. That's a very common ending. It's a good one to get used to. Because you'll use it a lot. Hawaiian music, blues music, country music, it can go for anything. It's basically the timing for it is 1 2 3 4 1 1 1 strum strum strum, and you go 1 4 1. So you basically you get five beats of the one chord, then the five, and you go back 1 2 3 4 strum strum strum, right? And that strum 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 probably takes a little bit of practice to get used to it, but once you learn it once, you're good to play that ending in that key from here on out, right? I've got a couple young girls that I teach down in town, and I try and get, okay, C, G, 7, C, and they've gotten to the point where they do that. They know that that's the ending for our songs, where we go 1 2 3 4 C, G, 7, C. That's the ending. That's what we use, and it's the same exact thing as here. Okay, so if you folks have any questions, throw them in the chat. I think we should do another song. Let's see. Are there any questions? Rita says, I think at some point that a list of easy tunes to practice would be helpful. Yeah. So like, it's really nice to know when you have 1, 4, 5 songs. I think Jimmy Buffett is a really solid bet. Especially his early stuff is like very, very kind of country crossover folk, really straightforward. And I think I'm on the a white sport coat and a pink crustacean playlist. So I think maybe we will use another song off of this album to try out. But yeah, it's just if you can find, like I have on the website, I've got a page of easy songs. Let's see, let me pull that up. And I'll post a link in the chat. And you can look and see what chords are in the song. Or I've got it as the chords that are on the sheet as it's written out for ukulele or whatever. Because it's supposed to be easy songs. But I think you can use, like, don't look at the sheet, of course. But you can use those songs as inspiration for like, okay, these are songs that are straightforward. And maybe go, like the oldies songs are gonna be kind of 1, 4, 5, and the country folk songs 145-ish. But if you just like look up, or even if you ask, I found that ChatGPT, despite all of its weirdness and being not very helpful most of the time, it's actually good for song ideas. Say like, give me 100 songs that only use 1, 4, and 5 chords. And it's like searched and compiled all of the data from different like guitar lists and piano lists and all the websites and like compiled the information more so than a single person like myself could do to put on a page. So that might be a good route to find some 1, 4, 5 songs. Okay, so if you're just joining, welcome. I'm just figuring out some songs live, sharing some tips, sharing some insight, and yeah, if you like what I've got going on here, I'm going to be doing a live Zoom workshop in a couple Saturdays, 2 Saturdays, I think, on the 27th. Yeah, we're going to be talking about movable chord shapes, and it's not related to playing by ear, but if you like the style, you need something to do, there will be a replay available afterwards if you can't make it in person. That could be a nice, it'll just be a nice overview of how chord shapes work and how things move together in zones. And I hope that you can join. If you go to liveukulele.com/store, you can find out more about that and register yourself. Hope to see you there. Thanks everybody for being here. Let's get into another song, because there's nothing, like, we can talk about this all day, but it's, I like the fact that doing it live is like doing it. We're doing it together. We're figuring it out. I'm, you know, holding myself and trying to jump, I guess, like, not go too fast and sit back and really kind of listen as you folks might hear it. And so hopefully, let's do He Went to Paris. I've heard this song, so it's a little bit more cheating, but I know that it sounds more complex. I don't think it's a very complex song. We'll find out. But I know that this one doesn't have any swear words or anything for my life, so we'll use this song. He Went to Paris. This is one of his biggest hits. And it's kind of slow, so we need to change our pace and adjust. So just listen to the rhythm.
He went to Paris, looking for answers to questions that bothered him so. He was impressive, young and aggressive, saving the world on his own. But the warm summer breezes, the French wines and cheeses put his ambition at bay.
Okay, it's another lovely 1-4-5 so far. So let's try and figure out what key we've got. And so for this song, just for demonstration purposes, I think I have a hunch what key this one's in. But just for demonstration purposes, let's look at the other way that you can usually figure out the key to the song. And this one's a little more involved. It's maybe easier to execute, but understanding it and using the information is harder, because what you're going to do is you just pick notes and diddle until you find notes that fit or don't fit. And then what you're trying to do is you're trying to create an overview picture of what notes are in or out of a key. And if you look at a key chart for all 12 keys, if you play one note and you find that, okay, this note works, you're going to have six, seven keys that have that note in it. Then you play another note, like, okay, this note and the other note only are in a couple keys. And then you keep eliminating until there's only one option left. This doesn't always work, because sometimes you'll play in a like a modal kind of song where things shift a little bit and you're not working necessarily in a straight major key. But in this case, it's a major song. It's straight ahead 1-4-5. So I'm just going to play some notes and try and listen for whether they match against the song or not. Okay, so if I pick F, does not really meet. But what if I go up? You're only ever one fret away from a right note. So if I go up or down, it should fit, theoretically. So if I go down to E,
he went to Paris,
okay, that sounds nice.
Looking for
And we also had going up, so we could probably expect that the F sharp will sound good too.
He was impressive, young and aggressive.
Okay.
Saving the world on his own.
Okay, so I just went up one more fret there to the G. And the G didn't fit. It sounds kind of bluesy when we put it against the rest of the song. All right, so E, F sharp are our two notes that are in so far. You go to G, not so much, but I bet G sharp. So the G sharp is kind of weird too. But I think that one is probably there. What you can do, the nice thing about this is you can defer your decision. Because there's multiple ways to get to the destination. If you're not sure about a note, go to a different one. Find a different spot. Because the odds are that you don't need that one specific note that you're not sure about. Use ones that you are sure about, and you can probably get to the same destination without having to guess as much. Okay, so I think G sharp, but I'm not sure. So we're just going to stick with E and F. Okay, so what keys have E and F in them? Well, it could be the key of A, it could be the key of D, it could be the key of G, could be the key of E, could be the key of B. It's a lot of options right now. But what if I go from the E and I go down a fret? Let's see if that fits.
He was impressive, young and aggressive, saving the world.
No, so I think it's the D, maybe. And once again, the D is not a super solid bet, but it's a more solid bet than whatever the G sharp was. So I think so far we have E, F sharp, D, and this doesn't have to be in any particular order. You can, if anything, like print out a sheet that has all of the keys on it, and you can just cross off the notes that don't fit, that kind of a thing. So you see what keys it might be. That might be helpful at first as you're learning how to do this. Because eventually you'll be able to just do it in your head. Like, I can just play a couple notes and know what key we're in just because I know that, oh, this note and this note fit only in this key. So that is the end goal, but getting there, it might be helpful to have the paper to write things out on, okay?
He went to Paris looking for answers to questions.
Okay, C sharp also seems to kind of work.
He was impressive.
So now I have a line of kind of notes that work, that would work in the melody. C sharp, D, E, and F. Okay? And this tells me that I think this is only going to be one of two options. It's going to be either A, the key of A, or it could be the key of D. So to test either of those things, we could play the root note where we hear that there's the one chord. So if I play D, it doesn't really fit here on the one, so I guess it's the A. So we're in the key of A, right? That only really works, though, if you know you're on the one chord, if you're over the one. And like the song that we did before, we're kind of just pedaling here at the beginning on the one, which is really great, right? Thank you, Jimmy. You thought of us when you were writing this song. Okay, so key of A. So you can play the A chord there. That's our one.
Looking for answers to questions.
Okay. And then we have a change. If we expect and assume that this is 1-4-5, we got two options. We have either the 4 or the 5. It's the 4.
He went to Paris looking for answers.
Okay, in this case, D in the key of A. And then back to the 1.
He was impressive. Young and aggressive.
I think it's the same thing again.
Saving
4.
The world on his own.
Oh, and then it goes up to the 5. Right? And I know that it goes up to the 5 because I've heard what the 1 is before in the song, right? And we haven't played the 5 yet. So when it makes that one change, I already kind of have a baseline for where the 1 and the 4 are as their own sounds. And when we get the third sound all by itself because it hasn't been played yet, I just know that, oh, that's going to be the five, you know, assuming that this is a 1-4-5 song, which I am. But that makes our life a little bit easier. Okay? Okay, so D, 4, 1, back to the A.
He was impressive, young and aggressive.
Same thing. But now we go up to the 5.
Warm summer breezes.
Okay. And then we kind of fall, but we're not going all the way back to the resolution. We're actually going back to the 4 again. Okay? And, you know, once again, it's only going to be one of the two options. It's either going to be the 4 or the 1 because we're on the 5. It's a triangle. When you have a 1-4-5 song, it's a triangle with arrows that go back and forth between each option. Okay? So, if you're on the 1, if the 1 lives at the top of the triangle, then you have 4 and 5. When you're on the 1, you're going to go one of two directions, right? You're going to go to the 4 or the 5. When you're on the 4, you're going to go to the 1 or the 5. When you're on the 5, you're going to go to the 4 or the 1, right? You only have that split option, which is really great because it keeps things simple and it doesn't allow us to get in our heads too much and to overthink and really, you know, get off the rails and in the weeds looking in places that we don't need. Because you could, when you're figuring out a song, you could totally just play every single chord. Is it a major chord? I don't know. Is it a minor chord? I don't know. I'm just going to play all the major chords and all the minor chords. And that's 24 options that you've got to cycle through and see if it fits. But as you're listening to the song, the chords are changing. So even if you do play the one that is correct, the correct chord, for the key, like the root of the key, you might be listening to that chord in a place where the song is playing on the 4, so you're all lost. So it's really helpful to keep it simple, find the key first, and then move along. Little disclaimer, you don't have to find the key to play the music, right? That's a big thing that Victor Wooten talks about. You don't need to find the key to know the music. You can just play. Just like play something that sounds nice with regards, and your ear will tell you what fits and what doesn't. That's where it's like when people start learning to solo and you play little improvised melodies, don't overthink it. Just play what sounds nice, play what fits. Don't try and think about the scale. If you play a sour note, then just slide it up or down a fret. Find, you know, massage it until it works. That is a lot of times a better approach than trying to think about every single note, because by the time you've thought everything out and you know what the safe notes are, the song's over already. So it's helpful to find the key in regards to, like, okay, so 1-4-5, that's straightforward enough to figure out the likely options for the song. That's good in this situation, but it's not always the case. You don't always need to know what the key is to just play.
In the world on his own.
Okay, that's 5. And here we have the fall back to the 4.
French wines and cheese.
The 1.
Put his ambition
at bay. And the 5. Okay, so those are kind of some fast changes. Let's play through that again and listen to what happens. Let's go all the way from the beginning where we're pedaling steady on the 1. So this is A.
Paris, looking for 4. Answers to questions that bothered him.
1.
So.
All right, we're resolved.
He was,
we can stay here all day.
Young and aggressive.
Then we lift.
4. Saving the world on his own.
More attention to the 5. Then the 4.
Warm summer breezes. French
1. And 4.
Put his ambition at bay.
And we turn around on the 5.
Summers and winters.
And we're back at the beginning of another verse, I think. Nope. I have to take that back. That's kind of like a tag thing. It almost sounds like a new, it's like a different part. Okay, so that's just 1-4-5 and then back.
He went to England, played the piano, and married an actress named Kim. They had a fine life. She was a good wife and bore him a young son named Jim.
Then we fall to the 4.
1. All of the questions.
four, five. One. And here's the tag thing. Four, five, one. Oh. Okay, so we have a solo break, and the chords change. You hear it gets dark. It goes to a minor chord. Okay. So, minor chord. It gets dark. That's fully resolved there. So we've gone back to the A. So we just need to figure out what the minor chord is to move through this, okay? So, you have in a key, we've kind of covered this a little bit already, but in any key you have three major options. You have A, D, E, or E7 in this key of A. Those are the 1, 4, 5. Those are the major options. You have a counterpart set of three minor options in a given key, okay? And so in this case, they're kind of the inverse. Wherever there's a gap in the key, there's the minor. Wherever 1, 4, 5 leaves the gap in the key, there are minor chords. So you have 1, 4, 5. That means that 2, 3 are going to be minor. In this case, so you have A major, and then the two would be B minor, and the three is C sharp minor. And then we get back to D. That's our four. And then E7, 5, and then 6 is F sharp minor. So B minor, C sharp minor, F sharp minor. There are 7 notes in a key, but the way that the chord that's based on the 7th note of the key functions essentially as a 5-7 also. It's a diminished thing, but nobody really uses it as that. It's just another turnaround. So there's really only the 6 main chords in a given key. And so you have A, B minor, C sharp minor, D major, E major or E7, and then F sharp minor. Those are your main options, okay? So our minor chord here, it doesn't sound like a weird minor chord, so it's probably gonna be B minor, C sharp minor, or F sharp minor. Let's see if we can figure out which one it is. He liked quiet. Clean country. So we're gonna turn around. 20 more years slipped away. Oh. Okay, so it's not B minor or C sharp minor. And sometimes you have to work kind of fast, right? Because that chord only lasts for a little while. So if you can kind of move through some options quickly, you can work a lot faster. So in this case, it's not B minor or C sharp minor, so I expect that it is the F sharp minor. Yeah. Then it goes back to the 1. Minor. Okay. Now that, do, once again, is our, you can try all the 1, 4, 5s there. Da. It kind of works on the E7. But it's not the 5-7 chord, it's something else. Which the first, it's not a minor chord either if you listen to it. It's got that kind of twangy lift. And when you go there, the first option that you should probably look at is the 2-7, right? We had the 2-7 in the last song. So in A, you have A, B. So it's gonna be B7 in this situation. Okay, and I think in the other song it was 2-7 to 5-7, but in this case, if you try that, I don't think it fits. It's the 4. It goes to the 4, and you can hear it there at the end, if I kept playing it. 4, and then it lifts one last time before going back to the 1. Okay, so that full bridge thing. guitar minor. One. Minor. B7. D, the four. Then five. One.
Well, the war took his baby. Mom's killed his lady and left him with only one eye. His body was battered. His whole world was shattered. And all he could do was just cry.
Why? Four, I think. Yep. It's all the same.
Answers he never found.
As the five, we move from the pattern a little bit.
So he hopped on a freighter, skidded.
And here's the tag. D, E7, A. Is this the outro already? No. All just one.
Now he lives in the
okay, last verse.
Fishes and pilots, drinks his
four,
green label each
one.
Day. Writing his memoirs, losing his hearing, but he don't
four,
care what most people
five,
see. Through 86
four,
years of perpetual
one,
motion, if he
four,
likes you, he'll smile
up to the five.
And he'll say, Jimmy, some of it's
one,
magic. Some of it's tragic, but I
four,
had a good life
five,
all the way. He went to Paris, looking for answers to questions that bothered him so.
Okay, that last bit changes.
Paris, looking for
changes a little bit. Thanks for tuning in, Leslie. See you next time.
He went to Paris, looking for answers
four,
to questions.
Okay, so that's a tag, but it's like a double time tag. Well, not double time, it's like extended time tag. Because we had the pattern. Da 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 da. So it's like 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. But for this one, it extends. And this is kind of a common thing, too, that you'll like another ending variation that you can put in your tool bag. Da 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 da. Da na na da na 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 da. 2, 3, 4. One down, 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 down. Right, it extends. It's the same pattern. It's the same thing. It's just happening for longer, and it's pushing out.
Searched questions that bothered him so.
I think I made it too long, but that's the idea. And then what is the ending? Do 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 do. Yeah, another kind of country-ish sort of ending. But yeah, that's the idea. If you folks have any last questions about that, throw them up in the chat. I'll hang around for a little bit longer. But that's the idea. I think that if I had to guess, this whole album, just like hearing kind of the vein and the style that it's in, is probably really great. A white sport coat and a pink crustacean. Here, I'll put it right here in the chat. If you folks want to look through it, maybe try and figure out a couple more of the songs on your own. It's really something that just takes a lot of doing. You have to spend time doing this a lot. You won't get it just easily by not doing it, by sitting around and thinking about it. It's one of those things that just do it a lot, and your ear is going to get a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better, and it'll go faster and faster, and you'll be, you know, less frustrated as you go, because it can be frustrating at the beginning. I suppose I'm even at this slow pace of explaining, I'm making it look pretty easy because I've figured out thousands of songs this way just listening, because that's all you have to go on. We live in a time when there are lots of tabs, there's lots of sheet music, there's lots of books that you can buy with transcriptions. These are wonderful resources, but there a lot of times, like, I don't mean this to diss on anybody who has a Jimmy Buffett book, but you shouldn't need a Jimmy Buffett songbook to figure out Jimmy Buffett songs, in my opinion, because these are great platforms for learning how to play by ear, because they're usually simple songs, they're straightforward, they're nice to listen to. The instrumentation lends itself to hearing. Sometimes you run across a song that is like instrument, it's arranged in a way that's kind of complicated to your ear. But when you hear a nice song like some of these Buffett songs, they're really kind of just set up for this kind of a thing. So I would encourage people to take advantage of that. Take advantage of the songs that are easy to figure out and figure them out. Just sit and try and work your way through it and see how far you get. And this is the kind of thing too, where if you do some of the work and you learn it the best that you can, and you take it to a musician friend, or you take it to your ukulele club and you ask, you know, somebody there who's a little bit more experienced, like, I'm working on this thing, but I can't quite figure out what chord this is. Can you help me fill in the blank? That's something that a lot of folks can easily do to help out, and they're happy to do, and it doesn't take them very much time. Like when I have people in lessons or whatever, and they say like, oh yeah, I want to figure out this song, but I can't quite get it. It's like, that sticking point for them is really difficult, but it's easy for me to just provide that information quickly and fast. And it's something that, you know, just a little bit of a push can get you over that hump to help you figure it out. So if you can't quite get something, you know, make sure you're not figuring out songs that are super duper complicated, but also don't be afraid to reach out for help and share what you have as far as progress. What's a little bit annoying as a teacher is when folks are like, you know, I want the song sheet for XYZ, and that the people haven't put in any time to trying to figure it out on their own. Where I grew up, like, there wasn't even a song sheet. There was nobody to ask. You wouldn't even dream of asking, like, oh, do you have a tab for whatever? Because we knew that, like, it wasn't there. If you wanted it, you had to make it yourself. So you'd sit and you'd figure it out. And, you know, maybe when you ran across somebody who was a little bit better, you could ask them, like, hey, I'm working on this thing. You know this song? Do you think that this is right? What do you think it is? And I've corrected things that I learned incorrectly in my early years. I corrected them because I've had, you know, people like Herbota Jr. or whoever say, like, no, it's actually this chord. And it was really close, but it's a little bit different, and my ear wasn't hearing it at the point, and it, you know, it just wasn't something I was able to achieve at that point. So you just do the best that you can, and by doing that and working through it, you're going to be learning a lot, and you're going to be getting a lot better at music as a whole. I really feel like playing by ear is one of the most powerful things and most underused things that people can do as an ukulele player. It's like, play by ear. Don't use the book, especially like, you go to an ukulele group or whatever, those songs are engineered to be easy, usually. Usually it's straightforward stuff that everybody has agreed upon. It's like, this is a good jam. I can feel good playing it. I can enjoy myself because it's not too complicated. That is huge. Because if the group was full of complicated songs and everybody had to use a sheet, it would be a very different experience. But because a lot of times those groups aim to be casual, they aim to be approachable and just a good time for all, the songs are usually pretty straightforward. They're usually 1-4-5, or if they're not 1-4-5, it's some easy addition that makes sense within the context. And it's a great proving ground to try this out practically. Try and figure out the songs by ear. You even have the added value of having a bunch of ukulele players around you where you can watch them and see what their fingers are doing and just follow along. If you can't hear what the chord is, you can see it over there because the next person is playing, hopefully, right? Because they're looking at the sheet. But you can learn a lot more for yourself by existing just with your ears and just with your fingers and just with what you can notice from other people. And I think that that's a lifestyle, certainly. But it's also the reason that people are always amazed when they come to like Hawaiian music workshops and they see all the kids or all the people, like the kids who grew up here in the islands and learned in that just watch and listen and figure it out style. They're so amazed when they see them, like, they just play. They just exist in the music. They figure it out. They play a song. They're like, I don't know what chords I'm playing. It just sounds good. They're amazed when that happens just because, you know, they're not used to that. They haven't lived in that world. And I think that it really benefits everybody to spend a little time in that world. And it doesn't have to be Hawaiian music. Obviously, you know, Jimmy is in a similar vein, similar chord progression, similar simplicity. And It's something that I think everybody should pursue, and hopefully this gives you a little bit of an idea how to do that. If I'm going to wrap it up there, I feel like that's a solid helping of information and a couple songs that you can take out of this and go work on, you know, ironing out for yourself, really understanding what is happening. Even though I've told you what is happening, you need to understand it and internalize it and be able to play it yourself. I would encourage you to go back and revisit and like do it yourself and hear what I'm hearing and like, okay, so this drops here. Like, okay, maybe I don't quite hear it yet, but I get the idea. I'm going to try and hear it and get used to how the things move and that kind of a thing. So best of luck with that. Thank you all very much for tuning in. Once again, I have a workshop coming up on the 27th of April. If you are not registered already, you can register via the link that I'm going to throw in the chat right about now. Would love to see you there. We're going to be talking about movable chord shapes, how to play different chord shapes in different zones on the ukulele, how to play a song with just one chord shape up and down the neck. We're going to try and do some visualization stuff so you can like see concepts and not just hear about them and talk about them. It's like the practical application of what I talk about in my ukulele chord shapes book. You don't need the book to participate in the workshop at all, but it's kind of like the applied version of the reference book. So we'd love to see you there. Otherwise, if you go down in the stream description, I added some ways that you can support the channel, support the work that I do. It's all greatly appreciated. Thank you for being here. Hope to catch you next time. Please subscribe to the channel. I do stuff like this whenever I feel like it. So I'll see you guys next time. I hope you're well. And keep on jamming. Keep playing those songs and keep playing by ear. Aloha.